something kind of risky today. I want to invite you to close your eyes. Unless you're working the Roman cell, you're not allowed to close your eyes because they might not open quick. Okay, but I never want to close your eyes. And I want you to take just a long, deep breath and slowly let it out. Take a second long, deep breath. Slowly let it out. And one more long, deep breath. Slowly let it out. Keep your eyes closed. Are you relaxed? Have your shoulders started to kind of let go a little bit? Could you stay there for a while? Or are you like some of us, as soon as you close your eyes, that list starts running through your brain of all the things that need to get done, that list that's left at work, the homework, everything, there's no way you can relax at all. All right, open your eyes. And just remember, I can see your eyes are closed from now on. So go ahead. The pastor always knows. Today, as we continue in the series that Pastor Steve started about walking by faith, we are taking a look at Sabbath. The Sabbath which God designed as rest, a little like that, stopping and being quiet and relaxing, which for most of us oftentimes just gets completely ignored or twisted. And like that list is constantly running through our brain. There's things we have to do. There's no way in the world I can stop. Now, you remember last week that Kurt shared with us out of Exodus that the children of Israel were on their journey of Exodus, and God's provision of manna to them, the provision of that bread-like substance, which assured them that the God who had brought them out of Egypt was the God who would provide all of their needs, would meet their needs. God had only brought them out of the wilderness to lead them. He delivered them out of the hand of Pharaoh, and he was also the God who would provide for them. So our scripture today picks up on the story where Kirk left off in Exodus chapter 16, verses 22 through 30. Let me read to you. And on the sixth day, they gathered twice as much food, two omers of peace. When all the leaders of the congregation came and told Moses, he said to them, "This is what the Lord has commanded. Tomorrow is a day of solemn rest, a holy Sabbath to the Lord. Bake what you want to bake and boil what you want to boil, and all that is left over put aside to be kept until morning." And so they put it aside until morning, as Moses commanded them, and it did not become foul, and there were no worms in it. Moses said, "Eat it today, for today is a Sabbath to the Lord. Today you will not find it in the fields. 6 days you shall gather it, but on the seventh day, which is a Sabbath, there will be none." And on the seventh day, some of the people went out to gather, and they found none. The Lord said to Moses, "How long will you refuse to keep my commandments and instructions? See, the Lord has given you the Sabbath. Therefore, on the sixth day, he gives you food for 2 days. Each of you stay where you are. Do not leave your place on the seventh day." So the people rested on the seventh day. This is the word of the Lord. Would you pray with me? Father, as we come before you this day, on the Sabbath day, would you speak to our hearts? Would the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable unto you? We pray in your Son's name. Amen. Keeping the Sabbath day, the fourth commandment out of the Ten Commandments, has probably been one of the most misconstrued commandments there is of all the ten. So today, I'm hoping we're getting a new understanding, and we're going to use three words to understand it: rest, pray, and play. Now, before we go any further, I need to make a confession. I am probably the worst Sabbath keeper there is. When we close our eyes, my list is always running. It's always going. This idea of relaxing or stopping just doesn't work. In fact, when we talked in staff that this was the passage that Pastor Stephen assigned to me, some people laughed out loud. You know, the problem is that someone who doesn't take time off, it really isn't a compliment. But it's admired within our culture. It's a dichotomy, right? Busyness has seemed to become a virtue in today's culture. And in a recent study joined by Harvard, Georgetown, and Columbia University, this is what the authors found. Today, the most successful people are perceived as the busiest, with only scant time for sailing to the Caribbean. They found that through a series of experiments, that the busier person appeared, the more important they were deemed. But what we know is there's nothing really holy, much less exceptional or productive, about being busy. In fact, evidence actually shows us that we consider that the overwhelming and overworking can lead to health issues such as impaired sleep, depression, heavy drinking, diabetes, impaired memory, and heart disease. Busyness, in fact, seems to be more of a hazard than a help. And by the way, I'm not confessing the heavy drinking. Just to let you know. Fire, just to let you know, I'm not confessing the heavy drinking. So all that being said, what I want to let you know that this understanding of Sabbath for me is the growing edge. That means it's a challenge. So it's a growing edge. And so rather than coming out of deep learned experience, we'll work on that. Well, as you deal with Sabbath, you obviously have to start in Genesis as you understand the creation account. We're looking in Genesis chapter 2. On the seventh day, God finished the work he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. The word for Sabbath in Hebrew is sabbat, and it's translated to cease or to pause. And here's a passage that says that God rested, God sabbat, from all of his work. Now we assume that God was just tired. You know, God of the universe was tired out from creation. Or maybe more, God paused and said, now is a good time to be together. We know that there's no other commandment in the Bible that is talked about more often than the commandment to keep the Sabbath. It's emphasized in Israel's history over and over and over again. In fact, the Sabbath is so important. Look at what it says later in Exodus 31. It says, you should keep the Sabbath because it is holy for you. Anyone who profanes it shall be put to death. Whoever does any work on it shall be cut off from among the people. 6 days shall work be done, but the seventh day is the Sabbath, a solemn rest, holy to the Lord. Whoever does any work on the Sabbath day shall be put to death. Therefore, the Israelites shall keep the Sabbath, observing Sabbath throughout their generations as a perpetual covenant. It is a sign forever between me and the people of Israel that in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth. On the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. It's a pretty good choice, isn't it? Keep the Sabbath, be refreshed, or die. I mean, you know, it's pretty clear at that point. Go to church or die. So that's not the best evangelism program we have, but you know, it's interesting. So, but if you look at the passage in Exodus about keeping the Sabbath, there's a passage in Deuteronomy that talks about keeping the Sabbath. Exodus talks kind of more about resting from creation. Deuteronomy talks more about God's redemption and rest that he's given his people. Then all of it is calling to mind the fact that we owe everything to God who provides all of our needs. So that takes us to our first word, rest. You know, when we see the passage out of Exodus today, we see God's desire was that his followers would experience rest. That rest would be made possible by trusting in God's provision. So think about it. It's pretty amazing. For 400 years, the children of Israel have been slaves in Egypt. For 400 years, they came initially under Joseph and a Pharaoh who cared for them. But that care, after the passing of Pharaoh, became enslavement. In fact, history tells us that many of the major cities of Egypt, like Ramses and different things, were built by the Egyptian slaves. Their care had become one of slave labor. And now we find them in the wilderness. They've been delivered by God from the hand of Pharaoh and set out on this journey to bring provisions. As Kirk told us last week, probably saying that they were going on a straight line journey. But now they're wandering in the wilderness 40 years. They clearly had no idea how long it would be. But rather than stressing out and worrying about what they needed to make the trip, God invites them now to rest. And make rest possible. He provides for them double provision. Now, Kirk shared about the miraculous provision of manna. steps out every morning to be harvested, God met a very tangible need with a demonstration of His love for them. And we saw that God who provided for His children is the same God who wants to provide for us every day. But in today's passage, we find out that God did something much more for His children than just food. Something that they probably didn't know they needed or at least were afraid to ask for. Rest for body and soul. Picture your life as a slave, your life under a slave master, having no control of your schedule, no control of your life. That's been your entire existence. And now you are delivered by God's hand in an incredible and yet probably panicky way to flee from Egypt, to bring with you anything you could grab that was your belonging. Probably that old like the Roman sailor yesterday, just stuff just coming. You know, what we see today, pictures on the news and videos of refugees fleeing war-torn countries, fleeing, going with their only hope being packed in a bag all they could carry, hoping that the other side of this journey would be hope. In the midst of Israel's refugees of Israel, God says to them, rest. I've got you. Kind of brings new understanding to the words of Psalm 23, when David says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still water. He restores my soul. Free from anxiety and stress, free from ambition and adrenaline that drives us, free from self-sufficiency and independence, and maybe even free from fear. On our Sabbath, God calls us to trust, to rest, to be restored. So today on the Sabbath, receive for your weary souls rest. And as we understand rest and God's gift that He gives to us, it leads us then to worship, and in worship, to pray. In our passage today, the people are called to a solemn rest, a holy Sabbath. And one of the purposes was to bring their hearts towards God. God, who is one who loves them, God, the one who provided for them, and Sabbath was meant to be an acknowledgement of our hearts, of being dependent upon God and who He was. In keeping the Sabbath, we were saying, God, whom we put our trust in, and in prayer, we acknowledge that it's God whom we are dependent upon. Sabbath reminds us what is really important. In the gathering of provisions of one day at a time, it became a tangible lesson that depended upon God for our daily needs. Just as Jesus said, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Prayer tunes our hearts to God. Prayer frees us to completely depend upon God and the knowledge that we are not the center of the universe. Busyness can be our trying to be God ourselves and to think that we can accomplish everything on our own. Israel struggled with their lives and hearts before God and is kind of swaying back and forth like a pendulum. They either lived lives forgetting who God was and not keeping the Sabbath, or they lived lives of legalism and substituting obedience to external laws, thinking that equated to a relationship with God. But all along, what God really wanted from them were their hearts, and all they gave them was restricted human effort. Oftentimes, Israel, the Sabbath just turned to a set of rules and laws to obey, thinking of keeping them that they were honoring God. And it's in this environment that we see the interactions between Jesus and the Pharisees in the New Testament. In the passage today, you read about Jesus' disciples walking through the field and picking some grains of wheat, and the Pharisees were upset. Why? It wasn't because of someone's wheat or not, but it's because they were working. They were working on Sabbath day. They weren't trusting in their mind, God's provision. They were breaking the law. And in breaking the law, catching the disciples, the Pharisees felt they were catching Jesus breaking the law. So how does Jesus respond? He responds by taking them back to the Old Testament, by reminding them that even King David, the king of Israel, when his men were hungry, went in the temple and ate consecrated bread because the need of the people was more important than the letter of the law. Jesus responds to the Pharisees wasn't to argue about the law, rather it's to point them back to Scripture, to see that God's real intent in giving the Sabbath was to meet our needs. The point is that God sees our needs more than he wants external obedience. The Pharisees are more concerned with keeping an external law. But this is seen even more clearly if you look later in the Gospels. We see when Jesus heals the withered man's hand. Again, the Pharisees are concerned that the Sabbath is being broken, and Jesus is saying, no, compassion and meeting needs is what's important. The Talmud, which is the commentary written by rabbis on the law, talks about 39 different laws that were gathered around the Sabbath. 39 different ones, almost all of them had to do with work or preparation, daily events. And the problem was, the guide was meant to guide people to rest, ended up becoming oppressive. For example, the Jews were prohibited from erasing or destroying any form of writing on the Sabbath. How'd that work out? It meant don't shred a piece of paper on the Sabbath. It meant you can open a box of food, but don't tear across the writing, because that was seen as work. Now, I know this for us, this can seem ridiculous, but yet, oftentimes, if you're like me, we then err on the other side just as far by not observing the Sabbath in any way. You see that pendulum swinging back and forth. We can also see in our culture today. Research tells us that really only 20% of people go to church at least once or twice a month. And normal attendance is not every week. Normal attendance is once or twice a month. Don't get any ideas, okay? Like, you do not have the rest of the month off here. We're not saying it's good. But the prophet Jeremiah talks about the same thing. In Jeremiah chapter 17, says this, thus says the Lord, cursed are those who trust in mere mortals and make their flesh their strength, whose heart turn away from the Lord. They shall be like a shrub in the desert. They shall not see when relief comes. They shall live in parched places in the wilderness, in an uninhabited land, salt land. Blessed are those who trust in the Lord, who trust is the Lord. They shall be like a tree planted by water, sending out its roots by a stream. It shall not fear when heat comes. Its leaves shall stay green in a year of drought. It is not anxious. It does not cease to bear fruit. Jeremiah is writing this because he's basically saying the reason Israel got taken into exile was because they quit observing the Sabbath. They left the very source of life. And what God desires from us is our hearts, that we rest in him, and that we depend upon him. Now, before I get overly spiritual or judgmental before myself, I need to realize there's some very important words here. And these come from David Hubbard, who is the former president of Fuller Theological Seminary and an Old Testament scholar. This is what he says. Christians must recognize that the cultic provision of the law were necessary to preserve the people of God, not only in exile, but in their return, until the law written on their hearts became a reality for the Holy Spirit that happened at Pentecost. The law written on stone had to be binding. So, we look at the Old Testament Sabbath and think, oh, well, why don't they get it? But we also realize that we get the incredible privilege or opportunity to live on this side of the cross and this side of Pentecost and know what it means to have the Holy Spirit within us. So, our next word, play. Now, that might be kind of a surprising word for you. Many of us grew up in states that had blue laws. Let's see, blue laws, yeah, blue laws, that's right. So blue laws, if you've never heard of blue laws were laws that were meant to help people observe the Sabbath. Basically, when you made things illegal, right? So stores couldn't be open, you couldn't go to movies, and you, for sure you couldn't sell alcohol. Apparently the thought was, well, if they're not in church, at least they're not drinking. I don't know. So, but in many states, you realize, in some states, you're still not allowed to sell or trade a car today on the Sabbath. I don't know. Just no car buying. But the idea was, we're going to make laws that that will then force people to keep the Sabbath, because that's what it is, right? Just you keep these laws and you're keeping the Sabbath. Well, it's hard to peg when those things kind of first started. Some people would say that maybe Reverend Samuel Pierce, who was a Puritan, introduced this Puritan legalism in the early 1700s in American colonies. What God had meant for rest and renewal had again been defined by camps, things you weren't allowed to do. And this was seen expressed in the Westminster Catechism. This is question 60 out of the shorter catechism. It says, how is the Sabbath to be sanctified? Answer, the Sabbath is to be sanctified by holy resting all that day, even from such worldly employments and recreations as are lawful on other days, and spending the whole time in public and private exercise of God's worship, except so much as to be taken up in the work of necessity and mercy. Well, it's that understanding that led to a story that made us know well, the movie Chariots of Fire, the story of Eric Little. He struggled, he was a famous runner from Scotland, qualified for the Olympics, but he was born in China, his family was in ministry, and ministry was in his future. Well, his sister was beside herself. She wanted him to dedicate his life to ministry, to the gospel, to go back to China now and do the work of ministry. His words to his sister, well, at least according to the movie, says, I believe that God made me for a purpose, but he also made me fast, and when I run, I feel his pleasure. His compromise was that he continued to run while he could before going back to China, but he would not run on the Sabbath, sacrificing his best races. Well, the very thing that gave him joy, a gift from God, came face to face with Sabbath practices. If he chose not to run because he wanted a day to dedicate to God, to rest and to pray and to do ministry to others, that's incredible. But if he chose not to run because of legalistic expectations, then what a loss. So here's the question. What renews you? Is it going on a hike? Is it planting flowers? Is it playing a round of golf? Is it baking cookies for a friend or playing music? Is it going out and working a soup kitchen? I love this quote by Bill Gautier, and he's a social scientist, a pastor, ordained pastor. He says this, praying and playing are deeply congruent with each other and have essential interconnections. What is it like to pray? What am I supposed to say? To play? Puritan Sabbaths that eliminate play were a disaster. Sickly Sabbaths that eliminated prayer are worse. Sabbath keeping involves both playing and praying. Activities are alike enough to share the same day and different enough to require each other for a complementary wholeness. All of us suffer from busyness. I deal with families all the time, my kids, and the one thing they suffer with is busyness. Their schedules, they are just on the run. From games, from practices, to school, to vacations, to two-parent, to two-income families. Busyness is one of the greatest struggles that families have today. And so now, I'm putting more guilt on you, saying, and by the way, also you should take the Sabbath, okay? Add that into your schedule. Remember, the starting point of the Sabbath is it's God's gift to us. But in order for us to receive that gift, it could be we need to get off the roller coaster every once in a while and stop. Sabbath allows us to reevaluate our priorities. What does it mean for us, just like the children of Israel, to trust in God's daily provision? Are we making harvesting manna more important than being with God? Do we sacrifice, and I say we, I'm talking about me, do we sacrifice prayer over play, or play over prayer? The answer is, I'm sure for most of us, is trying to find a balance between the two of those. Rest. Take a nap. Come to 11 o'clock service every once in a while if you need. There's nice people there too. It's okay. Let God restore you. Pray. Let God be the center of your life. One who provides and restores for your soul. And in so doing, see how God wants to help meet the needs of others through you. And then play. let God bring joy into your life through activities that bring you joy. But see it and see them as a gift of God, not to the exclusion of God. I want to end this morning with a prayer from St. Anselm. And it's interesting because he was known as the father of scholasticism. He was a scientist. He was an academic. He analyzed faith through reason. But at the heart of it was faith. Now listen to this incredible prayer. Pray with me as we close. Come now. Set aside your business for a while. Take refuge for a time from your troublesome thoughts. Throw away your cares. Let your burdensome worries wait. Take some time off for God. Rest a while in Him. Enter the secret room of your mind. Put up everything except God and whatever helps you find Him. Close the door of your mind and seek God. Say now to God with all your heart, I seek your face, Lord. Your face I seek.